The crown of England was found lying under a bush at the end of the Battle of Bosworth and placed on Henry Tudor's head. And Henry understood how you rule England. Not by winning over great nobles, they'd pretty well all been wiped out, but by winning over public opinion. The pen is mightier than the sword, especially when it tells the story of what happened.
Firstly, he must not be accused of killing a king, so Richard III was not king on the day of the Battle of Bosworth. Henry Tudor dated his reign from the day before the battle. It was Richard who'd been fighting against a king, not Henry. Henry was king. It was Richard who was the traitor. Got that? Secondly, he must deal with the question of his legitimacy as a ruler, so he married Edward IV's daughter. She was the legitimate line of descent from William the Conqueror, a true Plantagenet. Their son, when they had one, would be the legitimate heir by every possible standard. Well, so long as Edward IV's daughter was legitimate, so that had to be dealt with. All documents relating to the business of Edward's marriage to Elizabeth Woodville being invalid were destroyed. All documents relating to the illegitimacy of their children were destroyed, including the Act of Parliament that had spelt out why Richard should be king. These orders were carried out so efficiently that only one copy of the Act has ever been found. That's how we know about it. Other evidence may have existed, destroyed even more efficiently. And if the children were not illegitimate, then of course Prince Edward had been the true King of England, and Richard was a regicide. What a villain! Assuming, of course, that Richard had been responsible for the boy's death. Well, he couldn't be alive, because if he were, he, and not Henry Tudor, would be the rightful king. There are some nasty people who suspect that if the princes in the Tower were still alive before the Battle of Bosworth, Henry would have disappeared them. Richard III became the Saddam Hussein of Tudor propaganda. Never mind the legitimacy of the war to destroy him, it did the world a favour. Of course, the consolidation of power was not only a matter of creating favourable propaganda, it also involved getting rid of a few people. Clarence, for example, the Malmsey drowner, had a young son, the Earl of Warwick, a nephew of both Edward IV and Richard III. He had been barred from the succession, but so had the man now on the throne, so there was no security in that. He went straight into prison in the Tower of London. But then a priest in Ireland suddenly produced a 10-year-old boy who he said was the rescued Earl. The boy looked right, spoke right, had all the right manners. He was solemnly crowned in Dublin Cathedral as Edward VI. And a force of Irish supporters, backed by Flemish troops, then landed in the north of England. They were supported by the Earl of Lincoln, John de la Pole, who was also a nephew of Edward IV and Richard III. He was their sister's son. In fact, Richard III, who had no children, had designated John as heir to the throne.
John knew perfectly well that the child was an impostor, called Lambert Simnel, who'd been carefully trained for the project. The rebels had obviously assumed that Henry had killed the Earl of Warwick, so wouldn't be able to prove that Simnel was an impostor. They were wrong. The prisoner, still alive, was put on public display, and the rebels were crushed. But never missing a trick, Henry forgave the child and gave him a job in the royal kitchen. He grew up to be a royal falconer.
Another impostor appeared in 1492, this time claiming to be the younger of the princes in the Tower, Richard, Duke of York. His real name was Perkin Warbeck, and he stayed on the continent collecting support from anyone who fell out with Henry. Henry had persuaded Parliament to set up a special court to try members of the nobility who were a threat to the crown. A number of Warbeck's supporters suddenly found themselves arrested, tried for treason, and facing execution. This court was to become the notorious Court of the Star Chamber. Perkin was a constant irritant, first trying to invade from Ireland, then teaming up with the King of Scotland, and finally in 1497 he raised a rebellion in Cornwall, which Henry crushed, and promising leniency, persuaded Perkin to surrender. Perkin was imprisoned in the Tower, which of course already housed Clarence's son, the Earl of Warwick. And of course it wasn't long before evidence appeared that the pair of them were plotting a joint escape, and that was the end of both of them. There was one other person with a claim to the throne, Henry Tudor's mother, Margaret. In fact, whatever claim he had, she must have a better one. But no woman had ever ruled England in her own right. And Henry needed a son to inherit the throne. His eldest was named Arthur. This child of the blood royal was to be linked not just to the Plantagenets, but to patriotic English legends. But Arthur died in 1502, leaving his younger brother Henry as the Tudor heir. And in 1509, when the 52-year-old king died, Henry VIII succeeded to the throne.